and welcome to online worship with Northside United Methodist Church. We are so glad that you have decided to spend your Sunday morning with us. If we haven't had the pleasure of meeting, my name is Rachel Caracello, and I have the honor of being the pastor here in this place. We just want to invite you this morning to be a part of this experience of worship, to participate with us by opening your heart and your mind to the ways that God can change and transform you in these moments in time. Today, as we begin our service, we want to invite you to join us in singing together, "God is so good." The words will be on your screen.
Let us pray. Dear God, so often we come to you with lists and demands, spewing them out as commands. Without a second thought, we move on to the next task, going about our day, with no expectation that you will do anything in or around us, instead missing what you have to say. The noise of the world clogs our ears and clouds our minds in such a way that we can't even hear you. As we worship this day, open our senses to encounter you in every way, that even as we leave this time we've set aside to be with you, we might continue to listen for your voice in every moment of every day. It's in your Son, Jesus' name, that we pray. Amen. Please join us in affirming our faith together, and the words will be on your screen. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Last Sunday, I had the opportunity to go play piano at our partner church, St. Paul United Methodist Church in downtown Greenville. Bill Searcy is the music director there, and he sang, and I was able to play piano, and I really hope you enjoy our recording from last Sunday's service at their church.
Thank you. Our scripture this morning comes from the book of Esther, chapter 4, verses 1 through 17. When Mordecai learned all that had been done, Mordecai tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes, and went through the city, wailing with a loud and bitter cry. He went up to the entrance of the king's gate, for no one might enter the king's gate clothed with sackcloth. In every province, wherever the king's command and his decree came, there was great mourning among the Jews, with fasting and weeping and lamenting, and most of them lay in sackcloth and ashes. When Esther's maids and her eunuchs came and told her, the queen was deeply distressed. She sent garments to clothe Mordecai so that he might take off his sackcloth, but he would not accept them. Then Esther called for Hatak, one of the king's eunuchs, who had been appointed to attend her, and ordered him to go to Mordecai to learn what was happening and why. Hatak went out to Mordecai in the open square of the city in front of the king's gate, and Mordecai told him all that had happened to him and the exact sum of money that Haman had promised to pay into the king's treasures for the destruction of the Jews. Mordecai also gave him a copy of the written decree issued in Susa for their destruction, that he might show it to Esther, explain it to her, and charge her to go to the king to make supplication to him and entreat him for her people. Hatak went and told Esther what Mordecai had said. Then Esther spoke to Hatak and gave him a message for Mordecai, saying, all the king's servants and the people of the king's province know if any man or woman goes to the king inside the inner court without being called, there is but one law. All alike are to be put to death. Only if the king holds out the golden scepter to someone may that person live. I myself have not been called to come into the king for 30 days. When they told Mordecai that what Esther had said, Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, do not think that in the king's palace you will escape any more than all the other Jews. For if you keep silent at such a time as this, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another quarter, but you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to royal dignity for just such a time as this. Then Esther said in reply to Mordecai, go gather all the Jews to be found in Susa and hold a fast on my behalf, and neither eat nor drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maids will also fast as you do. After that, I will go to the king, though it is against the law, and if I perish, I perish. Mordecai then went away and did everything as Esther had ordered him. Folks, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Yeah.
This week, we are continuing on in our sermon series about the book of Esther, called For Such a Time as This. And we are tracing the theme of courage throughout Esther's narrative as a way for us to learn how to step out boldly in faith as the people of God in this uncertain season in which we are living. In case you haven't been with us the last couple of weeks, or maybe you have slept a couple of times since then, I want to remind you where we are in Esther's story. Esther is taken into the king's palace to become the king's next wife. But Esther is a Jew, and no one knows that. It's about to become complicated in this situation. Esther's cousin Mordecai, who helped to raise her after she lost her parents, is down at the king's gate, and he is refusing to bow down to the king's newly appointed official, Haman. And because of Mordecai's disobedience and his unwillingness to bow down to anyone but the one true living God, now Haman has put forth an edict with the help of the king to kill every single Jew in the province. The drama is going to continue building today as Esther has an important choice before her: to go to the king, even with fear for her life, and to ask that he revoke that charge, or to shrink back into the shadows and to not step out in faith. We are so glad that you are joining us today as we continue on in Esther's story, and as we all prepare our hearts for how God would speak and move in our hearts this day, would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, every single moment that we set aside in worship and praise of you is a gift. And so we offer these moments in time in which we have paused to make our focus totally you. We offer them as what we have to give, and we pray that you would speak to us through these moments in time. Holy God, speak through me and with me and even in spite of me, that above all else this morning, your gospel would be preached and received. It's in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen. Her heart beats with unquenchable ferocity in her chest. And suddenly she can't bear it any longer. She doubles over in fear and trembling on the floor, head hanging down in disbelief, one arm holding her up while the other wraps around her midsection, pressing into her body in an attempt to quench the pain and the uncertainty that wells up inside of her. There's no denying it. Whether she succeeds or whether she fails, she knows without a doubt that this will be one of the most defining moments of her life. On the other side of this wall where she cowers stands the greatest challenge that she will face. Will it be the beginning of a beautiful story of new life for a whole body of people? Or will it be the first nail in the coffin of her own funeral proceedings? Will she courageously step out in faith no matter the consequences, or will she step back in fear, more concerned with her own self-preservation than the salvation of her people? As she glances down at her body, she can't quite get over the irony of it all. How did she end up here? While every other Jew throughout the kingdom has spent weeks donned in sackcloth, covered in tears and a thin blanket of ashes, she has dressed in robes of royalty, ornate, colorful gowns meant for a party specially stitched to form fit her figure, fabrics hand selected to best accentuate her beauty and her style. While the rest of the Jews have mourned and wailed in the streets of the city, she has dwelled in the luxury and the comfort of the palace's whitewashed walls. While her people have nearly cried themselves into dehydration, knowing that their death sentence comes at no less than the hands of greed and the desire for ethnic domination, she quietly hides her Jewish identity, weighing the chances that in the midst of her silence and her royal privilege, she might not be found out. One thing they never tell you: when you dream of becoming queen as a little girl, is how heavy it weighs on your body. The earrings and the necklaces, the bracelets and the rings, the sashes and the scepters, but more than anything, the crown. On her head, it sits made of pure gold, filled with a pop of color of the most precious jewels gathered from all across the kingdom. Nothing less than the best for the king's most treasured wife. But in all of its beauty and its weight, the crown hurts her neck at the thought of holding up its massive weight on her head. But even more so, it hurts her soul. Because with the crown comes the weight of a responsibility, a life-giving or a life-ending duty that she never dreamed she would have to bear. So here she sits, a young, innocent woman named Esther, crumpled up in a ball on the sleek and well-kept floor of the palace. And as her shoulders heave silently in unison with the tears that stream down her face, she wonders, "Will I have the courage to turn this corner, to speak and to act on behalf of those whose voices and lives never quite get heard? Or, in my fear, will God have to use somebody else?" Down at the gates leading up to the palace, a Jewish man sits on the dusty earth, plainly dressed in sackcloth and ashes. His legs are tucked underneath him as he bows down in prayer before God, earnestly asking and hoping that God's hand might be upon his cousin Esther, the beautiful woman who now serves the province as their queen. No one even knows that he is praying, for Mordecai's eyes are open, waiting expectantly for an answer to his prayers, for news to rush down the hill from the palace, carried by the young and energetic feet of the royal servants. As he waits and he prays, he can't quite help but worry that this particular predicament is all his fault. It seems like such a good idea at the time to push his orphaned cousin Esther into the lineup for the palace's next leading lady, to cheer for her as she participated in the beauty rituals and contests, to be elated when the king chose her out of all of the women to marry, to spend some time congratulating himself, Mordecai, because he had provided Esther with the life that he had never had, the life that he knew she deserved. Without a doubt, he knows that she is well cared for within the palace's walls, pampered and fed and clothed to her heart's delight, respected by the servants and cherished by her husband king, who doted on her with 10 times more affection than any woman he had ever loved before. It all seemed perfect, A once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for the young and beautiful Esther to cruise through her life without a care in the world. But Mordecai never intended for them to end up here. All the Jews in the kingdom are to be slaughtered, read the edict. And below it, in smaller letters, so small that you had to squint your eyes to see, was penned the planned date of their destruction. Mordecai couldn't help but feel that it was all his fault. Every single day, that pompous, low-life government official had paraded himself down by the gates, demanding that all people bow in his presence, and Mordecai quite simply had refused. He would not lower his head to one so evil. He would not hand out his reverence and his worship to anyone other than the one true God. If the decision had to be made between his faith and the king's politics, he would choose his faith every single time. But following his refusal, immediately the edict came. If this Jew refused to bow down to the empire, then every single Jew in the kingdom must be killed. In the comfort and the shelter of the castle, it took Esther a little longer to hear what was happening, to find out what her husband and his officials had ordered. In fact, the news only reached her in the gossip of her servants, who just couldn't seem to keep quiet about the biggest news on the docket of that day. Immediately, Esther sent one of her servants to go where she couldn't, to grovel at the feet of Mordecai down in the streets of civilization, to receive the full story from the lips of a Jew who knew it well, to send him a decent outfit that he might take off that ridiculous sackcloth of mourning. Like that person who tells you when you're sick or upset that if you just looked better, you would feel better. Esther's gift of clean, well-tailored clothes, though heartfelt, were refused by Mordecai. For he knew that that band-aid of a solution, that quick fix, would only serve to relieve his pain for but a moment. If anything, donning those clothes would only serve to make Esther feel better, to aid in further blinding her privileged ivory tower eyes from the pain in the hearts of the ordinary Jews in the street. So Mordecai did the only thing he knew how to do. Through this messenger, he pleaded with Esther, sending her a copy of the edict, the death sentence, and a detailed explanation of its implications. Because maybe, just maybe, she might read these words and believe that they were true. Maybe, just maybe, she would turn that corner into the king's inner court, step out in faith, and advocate for her fellow Jews. Nearly before the message had even made it back up the hill and into the queen's quarters, she already had an excuse prepared. Mordecai, don't be stupid. Every single person in the kingdom, whether lowliest servant or highest official, knows that no one can go into the king's presence without being asked. For if they do it, they will die. Only if the king reaches out his scepter to them will they live. And I myself have not been called into the king's presence for nearly 30 days. How do I even know if he loves me anymore? But Mordecai refuses to let Esther settle for anything less than her purpose and her calling from God. And so in a desperate attempt to remind her of who she is, he replies with this urgent message. Esther, just because you live in royalty doesn't mean that he won't kill you too. If you don't act, God will send deliverance through another means, through someone else. But just remember, a lot of people could have been where you are right now. Through the exile and the beauty pageants and the royal lineage and the journeys back to Jerusalem. But who knows? Who knows? Maybe God brought you to this exact place, to this exact royal position, you and no one else, for such a time as this. Curled up in the floor of the palace, one arm holding her up and the other wrapped around her midsection. Esther can't help but hear those words from Mordecai echoing in her head. Cycling around and around on repeat over the tears and the sobbing and the pain of fear in her belly and the heart that beats with unquenchable ferocity in her chest, she hears those haunting words over and over again. Who knows? Who knows? What if you were brought right here for such a time as this? As the words roll around in her head one more time, she finally gets the tiniest jolt of strength and of courage. No more and no less than just what she needs for that moment in time. To push herself up off the floor, to wipe the tears from her eyes, to straighten her crown. And with a deep breath that inflates her entire body, she takes the first step that she has been dreading. She turns the corner that might make the difference between her life and her death, and she boldly stands before the king and asks him to act, to speak on behalf of those that he and the powers that be just can't seem to see. Church, this morning I want you to know that we can spend our whole life trying to cover the sackcloth and the ashes of this world with the quick fix of a new pair of clothes. We can pretend that somehow if we blind ourselves to how much the world is hurting, then we won't have to step out in faith to speak and to act on behalf of the people that the powers that be just can't seem to see. We can easily be convinced that the edicts that come from the top don't affect us from the position of privilege where we sit. But the scriptures cry out to us this morning, dear church, if you don't act, God will send deliverance through someone else. A lot of people could have been where you are right now. In fact, you could have lived in 1,000 different generations. You could have built your life in a place other than Greenville, South Carolina. You could have been gifted and passionate about things other than the ones that keep you up at night. But who knows? Who knows? Perhaps God brought you to this exact place. Perhaps God laid those exact passions on your heart. Perhaps God has been preparing you for this exact moment over the course of your entire life. Dear friends, we can live all of our days in the comfort and the security of the hallway. or we can turn the corner. And we can take that first step that scares us the most. May God grant us just the amount of courage that we need. Because who knows? Perhaps God has brought you to this place, to this moment in time, to this generation and this season, for such a time as this. May we be faithful. And may we allow God to use us where He sees fit. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, it is so clear that there is so much going on in our world right now, that there is so much that has happened in our community since the last time that we were together. As if the COVID-19 epidemic wasn't enough for us to try to handle mentally and spiritually right now, most of you all know that on last Saturday night, our community here in Greenville was also affected by an EF2 isolated tornado. A few in our congregation were affected, and many even beyond our walls here are figuring out how to pick up the pieces, how to rebuild their homes from the ground up. And I know that all of those things bear a huge weight in your lives and in your hearts this day. Griff and I have been surprised this week that one of the greatest gifts for us, even though our parsonage just sustained a minor damage, thank goodness, with all the trees down, one of the things that has been the greatest gift to us is for people being willing to listen to our story, just to hear us talk about what it was like to be in that closet and the fear that that brought to us. And so part of the way that I am going to step out in faith with you all this week, as we examine what it means to follow Esther's example, is I want to offer myself to you as a listening ear. I want to be there for you if you have something that you would like to share that is weighing on your heart. You just need somebody to hear your story. My email address will be at the end of this worship service today. Feel free to email me. Feel free to call our church office. The number is on our website and on our Google page. But until we are able to speak with one another, I want to pray with you and for you this day for all of the things that weigh on you. So would you pray with me? Gracious and holy God, you are our safe place to hide. You are our mighty fortress. You are our ever-present help in time of need. We can and do turn to you in the midst of our troubles. And Lord, you know that right now our world is so full of difficulties. Lord, we may feel afraid, but it does not overcome us, because we know that we can put our trust in you. And so in this season, we pray that your love and your grace would be like streams of water in the desert, that your joy would come splashing down upon and all around us, that you would refresh and renew us like rain that falls from the heavens and comes down to the earth. Please, oh God, bring your water of life to all those who are thirsty, to all who feel as though they are living right now in a dry and a weary land. Where there is conflict, O God, bring your peace. Where there is hunger, fill the empty bellies. Where there is despair, bring your hope. Where there is animosity, bring forgiveness and reconciliation. Where there is illness, bring your healing. And where there is grief, bring your gentleness and your care. And oh God, if one of us might be the bringer of your good news, of the good things that you have to offer us, if we are being called in these moments in time to be your hands and your feet to the opportunities that are literally all around us, we ask that you would give us that nudge, that you would cause us to step out in faith, to make that choice not to linger in the hallway, but to turn the corner and to know that you are with us, just as Esther did for the sake of her people. God, truly the hymn says it all. You are so good. And we know that we can trust you and trust that you are with us through all that we face. Give us the courage to show up for one another in this community and beyond, that all people, wherever they find themselves, might know and experience your love. God, we are so grateful for all the many blessings that you have poured down upon us, and we pray that our eyes would be open to see those each and every day. And out of that deep gratitude, we pray now in the way that your Son Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, in response to the word that we have heard this day, would you join us as we sing together, "Here I Am, Lord." The words will be on your screen.
Thank you.
who knows? Who knows? Maybe God has brought you to this exact place, to this exact moment in time, to this exact season in which we find ourselves for such a time as this. Maybe God is calling you to step out boldly in faith. May you listen to where God is leading, and may you trust that He goes with you wherever it is that He is calling you to go. May you find a way this week to love God, to love one another, and to love the north side of Greenville until we come together and meet again. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.